Good afternoon. I want to welcome everyone. Some of you can certainly come up and sit at the table, please. Don't be shy. I want to welcome you to this panel commemorating 100 years since the influenza pandemic of 1918-1919. It's usually called the pandemic of 1918, but because we couldn't schedule it until this semester, it extended a little, but there were cases in 1919. Before we begin, I just want to mention a couple of upcoming events at the Institute soon after spring break. On Thursday, March 28th, a book talk by Daniel Immerwahr of Northwestern University on his book, How to Hide an Empire, A History of the Greater United States. And on Tuesday, April 2nd, a particularly timely panel on Brexit in global and historical context. We never know in advance what our panelists are going to say, but in this case, we truly do not know what to expect. I want to thank Courtney Mador and Kazushi Minami, as always, for helping to set up today. So I want to say that we're very fortunate for today's panel to have three speakers who are bringing quite different perspectives to an analysis of the deadly outbreak of flu in 1918 that had devastating global consequences. In the interest of time, I'll keep the introductions brief, as well as my own remarks. Let me just say that given the completely understandable popular anxieties about pandemics, I'm old enough to remember the panic that greeted the first outbreak of AIDS in the 1980s, and of course also the Ebola outbreak of 2014. I'm especially glad to be part of a discussion that takes us beyond sensational headlines and Michael Crichton bestsellers. Let me introduce each speaker in turn, and we'll have a Q&A at the very end. So we're going to go in somewhat chronological order, starting with history. Abena Osseo-Asare is a historian of medicine and science in UT's history department. She brings a historical perspective and will speak on the flu in Texas. Her first book, Bitter Roots, The Search for Healing Plants in Africa, is a study of six plants that scientists in Ghana, South Africa, Madagascar, and other countries sought to transform into new pharmaceuticals. It received the 2015 Melville J. Herskovitz Prize in African Studies, the American Historical Association Pacific Coast Branch 2015 Book Award, and the 2014 Choice Magazine Academic Titles Book Award. She's completing a new book, Atomic Junction, Nuclear Power in Africa After Independence, which is under contract with Cambridge. The study examines the history of Ghana's nuclear program since the 1960s and the role of Ghanaian scientists in extending radiation protection services. Abena received her PhD in the history of science from Harvard University. She's taught in the history department at the University of California, Berkeley. She's a faculty associate of the new Health and Society major in the College of Liberal Arts, and she holds a courtesy appointment in the Department of Population Health at the Dell Medical School.
All right, so how many of you are good at spelling? In 1918, you might have been among this group of young people who assembled on the steps of the Capitol for the state spelling bee. Or perhaps, I use this anecdote in my lecture courses, how many of you are looking under your desk at your phone to check out maybe your Facebook feed or your Instagram feed? If it was 1918 and you were a student at UT, you might have been looking at a copy of the UT yearbook, The Cactus, because it had been recalled. There were issues with a group of lovely ladies who posed for photos. The administration felt they were a little too suggestive, and so that was what was under people's desks in 1918. Perhaps your mind was elsewhere. On Thursday, November 7th, 1918, the Dallas Morning News reported that a beloved nurse, Miss Eleanor Ingram Bain, had died at the age of only 38. And this was after her work fighting tirelessly to help those who were succumbing to influenza. She was originally from Edinburgh and joined the nursing staff at the Baptist Sanitarium in Dallas around 1909, so about a decade before. She even survived an epidemic of spinal meningitis, and so her fellow nurses were asking members of the public to consider attending her funeral service later that day. Influenza was taking its toll on the nation, and Texas was not immune in 1918. It was the time of the Great War, World War I, as it came to be known, since it wasn't the last war, and American soldiers were at the risk of death or capture by Germans, as was the case with this young man also featured in the Dallas Herald that day. What I want to talk about for, I guess now it's not 10 minutes, it's 18 minutes, so I'll talk more slowly, was the ways in which influenza became a global pandemic in 1918. Influenza was not a new disease. This advertisement is actually from the Dallas Morning News, published in 1917, a year before all of this really came to grip the country. And it explains that there was a new medication ready to repel invasion. The air swarms with the infection of colds, gripe, and influenza. When you're well, you fight them off. Let something occur to lower your vitality, and you are likely to prove an easy victim. But there is an adequate defense ready for you in Peruna tablets, an effective treatment that should be taken at the first indication of a cold, the period of depression invariably preceding the acute symptoms. And this tablet will arouse your resistance, strengthen your circulation, dispel the inflamed area that is a danger spot, and can help you speedily rout the attack. Now, influenza was not a bacterial germ that could be killed with a tablet. And so in my larger history of global disease, in my courses, we look at parasite-borne diseases, we look at the beginning of bacteriology and then virology. And so there's this moment where people do understand that there are little animalcules that are causing disease. It's not miasmas and vapor and putrefaction in the streets. But influenza poses a challenge because it isn't something that can be targeted in 1918 with a pill, or this is before antibiotics even. I mean, we're really being rolled out. So it's a very mysterious condition, and it's easily confused with other diseases. Influenza is linked to animal origins. We believe at least 2,000 years before the Common Era, when humans begin to domesticate animals, this may have initiated the disease since it jumps from animal hosts to human populations. There are early references, maybe 12 before the Common Era, Hippocrates wrote about an epidemic whose symptoms seem similar to flu. In the 16th century in Europe, there are records of perhaps three flu epidemics, and the word influenza comes from Italian, which means from nowhere, something that acts quickly and disappears. It was linked to the stars, to cold, and limited travel up until the 16th century may have limited the spread of influenza outbreaks. But by the 19th century, there were more and more reported cases of influenza. In 1833, at least half of European cities were impacted. About 250,000 people died in what we believe was an influenza outbreak. In 1889, there was a similar outbreak of what we think was flu in Asia that then spread to Europe. So wider ocean trade, railways, motor cars, even air travel may have increased the spread of flu. Now, earlier recorded outbreaks of flu before 1918, you have a big difference, which is that it was going to kill the very young and the very old. But in 1918, it was those at the prime of their life, like Ms. Bain, who died at the age of 38. So I'm going to give you a little bit background on how people tried to fight off flu and the ways in which it was linked to the Great War. I would say that the part that's most difficult for us to get our minds around is that it limits how much people really understood influenza in 1918. It was linked, and here's a series of causes that were collected by Garrett: nakedness, dirt, unclean pajamas, dust, open windows, closed windows, old books, fish contaminated by the Germans, Chinese people, cosmic influences. You know, so it's really very confusing as to what was causing influenza. Oops, I turned it off. Turn it back on. But by 1917, the United States could not escape the conflict in Europe, the Great War, as it was called, And by the spring of 1918, we believe influenza began in the United States, somewhere in the Midwest states. An epicenter was at Fort Funston in Kansas, in Haskell County. I don't know if I have anyone from Kansas, but shout out to Kansas. The soldiers were riding railways to military bases. They were passing through many cities. There was little attention in the press, but in retrospect, these first cases allowed influenza to get a foothold in the United States. This is an image from Camp Kearney in 1917. You can see the use of these masks. More about that in a moment. We think that this earlier outbreak in the United States in these military bases where soldiers were assembling troops, were coming together, the symptoms were fairly mild. And so it's going to then mutate and become more virulent, and that's what you have happening in Europe in the trenches. This newer virulent strain was killing healthy adults. It became known as the Spanish flu, so again, there was consideration that maybe it started somewhere in Europe and was linked to Spain, which was hotly contested by Spaniards in the media at the time. But phylogenetic tests suggest that it was related to this same outbreak that was happening in the US. At the time, people thought it was gas warfare, the introduction of chemicals in the trenches, and this might have been what was causing it, maybe a super germ that was in crowded conditions. And really, one thing that nobody in this room is gonna be naive about is that more people died from the influenza pandemic during World War I than died in battle, right? That is something that was forgotten. And more when I ask students, they are aware of this. I think it's made its way into maybe an AP exam question or something. A colleague of mine in history of medicine has infiltrated the system. But what we see with influenza in this 1918 outbreak is that 99% of the people who died of influenza were under the age of 65. So between the ages of 15 and 34 years, you had a 20 times higher rate of death than in previous flu seasons. And overall, US life expectancy was reduced by 10 years. It had an impact on World War I. Germany's last offensive on France was stalled, in part because 2,000 men per division had flu. Malnourishment impacted the troops, the delay in supplies, and basically about 80% of US military deaths during World War I were from flu, not battle. I meant to bring a book I use in my class, but I have a book on primary sources looking at flu outbreaks around the world, and I would say that I am focusing more on the United States for this moment, but flu definitely impacted places like ports in Sierra Leone, where they were doing fueling stations. It was in Cape Town in South Africa. Many ports across the world, especially during the war, were impacted. So it does have this far-reaching impact. So how did the US respond to the epidemic? The epidemic coincided, as I'm saying, with the final days of World War I. And when the influenza epidemic hit in the fall of 1918, there was a shortage of doctors and nurses. Many of the leading specialists were engaged in treating soldiers. And so the Red Cross hired people for $20 a week to work as nurses. Volunteers were used. And by October 19th of 1918, the Red Cross actually could not meet 50% of their calls. So if you can't go across with a gun, come across with your part of the Red Cross War Fund, in the sense that the Red Cross was this benevolent maternal figure who was going to help the sick, including those in the United States. It was a real crisis situation, and one that people combated with what? Masks. So the masks that people used in 1918 didn't do very much. If anything, they may have contained droplets of what might have been a secondary bacterial infection. But really what was going on in the period is people thought that masks were almost like screens that were keeping out mosquitoes. That was kind of an analogy that people use. Because again, it's this early germ theory. And so a lot of cities depended on masks and propelled young people to make masks. So some of this research is from my work in Texas and also at my previous institution at Berkeley. Students in 1918 were called together to create badges. During the influenza epidemic, 2,300 gauze masks were made of material bought by the University Red Cross Auxiliary, and the men of the School of Military Aeronautics, the Students' Army Training Corps, and the Naval Unit were supplied twice daily with freshly sterilized masks. Student committees had complete charge of this work. Several students substituted nursing for the surgical dressing and garment work. Funds used for this work were raised through the operation of the Red Cross Bookshop, tag days and candy sales. So I always tell my female students, what would you have been doing in 1918 if we confiscated your UT cactus yearbook? You would be sewing masks for your fellow male compadres who are going to go out and fight. And so it was literally people sitting around tables and making these masks in hopes that this was somehow going to save the country. Young people were really affected. The symptoms at first were muscular pains, fevers, headaches, later followed by vomiting, dizziness, breathing difficulties, increased sweating, and then severe nosebleeds, purple blisters, coughing fits, leading to death. And death could come within hours after the onset of symptoms. Red Cross volunteers around the country readied ambulances to take sick patients and often corpses away from their families, death carts, they were called. Poor families were more affected by the epidemic. They lived in more crowded conditions and had less medical recourse, and sometimes there were language barriers and concern about sort of state support and trust of medical establishment. So here we see the child of a migrant worker near Jefferson, Texas. This child was ill with influenza and had a high fever but was receiving no medical attention. Again, what could doctors or nurses or Red Cross volunteers do in this period? It would have been palliative care, it would have been a warm soup perhaps, even efforts to keep the sick away from others who are well in the household. I show a documentary, with any of you could look up online, PBS film about the influenza epidemic. It's still one of the better ones. There have been more recent ones, but this one was made long enough ago that people who actually lived through the epidemic can talk about their memories. And this horror of very healthy caregivers in the family, the mothers, the fathers, the teenagers, these were the ones dying, leaving young orphans. We lacked good records. This is a time of war. There are revolutions on the international scene. And so sometimes doctors were overwhelmed. They did not always list influenza as a cause of death. And in some places, no records were maintained. This is a funeral for Masako Hirata's baby sister, Tomiko, who died of flu in San Bernardino, California. This was something that was affecting communities across the United States. And influenza may have lingered until 1928 and caused other health problems, including Parkinson's, encephalitis, kidney problems, cardiovascular disease, and pulmonary disease. It's a time of coming together of communities. Telephones were used to share information. By October 18th, they were actually overwhelmed with calls. In San Francisco, you had 600 telephone operators who were absent, some sick, some had died, and it took about a month until they were able to even get the telephone service up and running. So imagine, you know, if you have to be on your phone checking social media every 5 minutes, imagine if you can't even call people to find out what's going on. So what could families do? Again, the emphasis was on the mask. It was thought that the flu bugs could be kept out. Again, this question of mosquitoes on a screen. First, it was just nurses who were advised to wear masks. In San Francisco, by October 22nd, the mayor said, wear a mask and save your life. The Red Cross, the Postal Department posted signs everywhere. And they were told that it was 99% proof against influenza. So people had really great faith in these. There were different kinds, homemade ones, muzzle masks, veils even, that women sometimes would use. And by October, in most cities, almost everybody was wearing a mask. The influenza, and I always point this one out too, even cats. The influenza vaccine was fairly ineffective in this period. Public health officials nonetheless tried to inoculate. The vaccine was being made in Boston, and they were shipping it around the country, literally by boat and also by train. People lined up for the vaccine, but it's thought that it was really, if anything, wearing the mask and people making soups was what might have staved off the disease. And we'll hear more about, hopefully someone will talk a bit more about the diseases, the vaccines. By the end of the war, by Armistice Day on November 11th, people celebrated. They had bonfires, they had parades, and you can see in this one, people are still actually wearing masks. At some point I had time to do this. But as I said, the pandemic lingers. by November, schools and churches had been closed in most cities for as many as 6 to 8 weeks. They started to be reopened. People stopped wearing masks, but it continues to be a problem with several thousand people still dying into 1919. You know, what was the hospital setting in this period and what did people have at their disposal? You can really see here, this is going to be open kind of area with lots of beds close together, probably not where you want to try and contain a flu outbreak. But it was sort of a public communal attention to those who didn't have caregivers at home. And you can see that even in a kind of calm hospital setting, that the attending physicians are not wearing gowns or gloves. I mean, it's a really different moment. And I think sometimes when people panic about disease outbreaks and they say, we could have another 1918, we actually couldn't. I mean, we have a lot of supportive care that we can give people that you couldn't have done in that period. It is true that we do need to